Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome at this Flock meetup session. We're here at Flock Community. Flock Community is a group of software engineers that try to build better software every day. We do that with a group of engineers, which are very dedicated to software engineering, to programming. We do that with projects. We do that at a different set of clients like DHL, like Bol.com, ING, and a few others. And today, we're here to listen to Jere. Jere is going to give a talk about pragmatic functional programming in the language Kotlin. My name is Julius, and I want to start with a question for all of you. And I was wondering if you guys could raise your hand, either by turning on your camera and actually raising it, or using the raise hand function, which is Control Command H if you're a Mac user. I'd like to see a show of hands for those who are familiar with Kotlin and have used it in their either personal or professional life. Oh, wow. That's basically everybody, right? Everybody's showing a hand. All right. Great. Then I guess the other question is going to be obvious. Who has experience with functional programming, either in their professional or personal life? That's almost as much, but a little less. All right. In that case, I'd say, take it away.
Yeah, thank you, Julius. So indeed, thank you also for the people that are joining in from home, or at least from online. It's really nice to see you all. And indeed, I want to talk about pragmatic functional programming in Kotlin. So first off, pragmatic. So when you learn about functional programming, I think a lot of people know is that when you start out, you learn about functions, effects, monads, and then you think, okay, what is this? And when you then read online about it, then it's a lot of theory. And then in the end, you still don't know what functional programming, monads, and all these applicatives and functors are. So I don't want to go in that direction and try to explain the theoretical side of things. But what if you already have monads? What if you already are working in a functional programming way? Or what if you want to just use it and use the nice things from functional programming in Kotlin in this instance? And how can you pragmatically approach that that programming paradigm? So that is basically, from the start, just some parameters keep in mind. And I wanted to talk about functional programming in Kotlin with Arrow, or without Arrow, as we're going to see. So I have a little agenda for you today. First of all, I want to review a little Spring application as a small introduction into where most of us come from. If I'm speaking for myself as well, I started programming in Java and Spring and Spring Boot to do dependency injection and stuff like that, object-oriented programming. So I want to start there as a sort of baseline to see where we're coming from. And from there, I want to go and introduce functional programming, what the benefits are, and how it's actually different to object-oriented programming. Then I want to talk a little bit about monads, because you cannot get around that if you weren't talking about functional programming. And then, of course, the meat of the talk will be about code in Kotlin with Arrow and without Arrow, about actually using functional programming paradigms and applying them in a pragmatic way. And then I will get to some kind of conclusion. So first off, I've already talked a little bit about it. There are some programming paradigms. For instance, if you're talking about object-oriented programming, which is an imperative programming paradigm, where you program in objects and basically say, do this, do that, do such and such. And then on the other hand, there is functional programming, which is much more uses a declarative style of programming, where you say, this is the recipe to actually execute. But of course, I will come back to this. But these are the programming paradigms that I'm going to talk about, and I hope most of you are familiar with. So first of all, object-oriented programming, which is imperative programming. One of the things you do in object-oriented programming is you define classes that are instantiated as objects, and then you interact on those objects through methods. These objects can have internal state, And an example can be a basket in a web shop where you add items, maybe remove items, and then in the end, save the whole basket to the database, for instance. And the main method actually starts the application. Of course, this is not a definition of object-oriented programming, but it's mainly how it's used and how you can recognize it. This style of programming actually encourages stateful behavior, like it's also meant to do that. It is meant to model the real world. For instance, in a web shop, that you have a basket that you can actually add items to and remove them, for instance. But this state increases actually testing problem space. So a lot of times in my work, where you need to test something that is stateful, you first need to actually get your program in a certain state. And then when you have your program in a certain state, only then you can actually test your logic. And in this way, testing an implementation that is tied to your state is cumbersome, because you need to do, as I said, a lot of things to actually get it into a certain state. Now, of course, it's solved partially by programming to interfaces, where you have a contract that you say, well, I have a repository and I have a test implementation and a live implementation. But it's we'll come to that. That's still not the solution. Now, if you program to an interface, then of course you also need to have a production implementation and a test implementation. So in a way, you're giving control away from your main method to some dependency injection container, where the main method is actually in the framework. So you're relegating this inversion of control, where you relegate your control to a framework, and you ask your dependency injection container for the dependencies that you actually want to inject. And dependency injection container that we're using most of the time and is widely used, of course, is Spring, and from that Spring Boot and all kinds of modules from the Spring framework. Now, in my mind, how I view this dependency injection container, whether or not you want to inject test dependencies or actually live dependencies, is somewhat like this. On the left-hand side, you have a main method that starts up your dependency injection container, where you register different dependencies, dependency A, maybe a service or a test repository, and then you have some logic where you ask the dependencies from your dependency injection container. And in Spring, this is annotation based. The beans, the sort of dependencies that you define, are instantiated on the reflection and injected on based on reflection. There is some magic string matching going on between the names of the dependencies and the actual arguments in your constructor. This is of course very stateful, because first you need to bring your context into a certain state. And that leads, at least in my experience, to sometimes runtime errors, where you, for instance, cannot find the bean that actually you need for your dependency injection. So in this case, in Spring, there are, of course, frameworks that do dependency injection that is more or less compile time safe. But in Spring, this is not the case. But it's all well and nice in theory. But in practice, most of the time, you want to actually get a controller that hooks into your HTTP traffic, and then you need to ask a dependency from the Spring context, which then might be a service that's injected into your controller. But then, of course, that service depends on another dependency, which is a repository where you might have your polymorphism. And of course, you don't know how deep this rabbit hole goes. So it could be very well that there are a lot of services that your controller depends on and a lot of repositories, and maybe there are other validators or other things that your dependency graph is using. So the thing that you actually want to replace in a test or a live way is actually the repository. So for instance, the repository is the polymorphic dependency that you want to replace in your live or in your test context. But you're still dependency injecting the service into your controller. So you lose sight of what your actual dependencies are in your program when you're programming, for instance, in a controller. So the question becomes, what is the real dependency? What is the thing that I actually want to mock? What is the thing that I really need to instantiate? And this can be cumbersome in the test setup, where from experience, if you want to actually test something, then if you want to mock a service, then you also need to actually implement a lot of methods and maybe even mock a lot of services, where in practice you would just be able to use the live service and just inject the repository. And of course, this is a real problem with a deep and broad dependency tree, because you don't know what is actually the polymorphic thing that you want to inject. So coming from a basic or a classic Spring Boot application, actually thinking about the methods and about constructors, you wonder whether or not, for instance, well, hang on, there is this functional approach, but in object-oriented programming, are methods not just functions? Or is a constructor not just a function? And is dependency injection not just passing parameters to your object? And if that is the case, then objects are maybe just data containers, but that's it. So what is this stateful thing that we have in OOP? Now, of course, the answer to these questions is no, methods are not just functions, and a constructor is not a function. But it's still, I think, a way of how you can approach functional programming that you are working with functions that change something. And this is, of course, a little bit vague, but this is also where the transition to functional programming is. Because if we are talking about these functions, then we actually need to view them as functions. So in mathematics, a function is not a procedure or a method where you can do side effects, for instance. So an actual function yields the same result if you provide the same input. So for instance, if you have a sum function that adds up to integers, in this case 2 and 3, it always yields 5. Another thing that you can say about a functional or declarative style of programming is that you mustn't do side effects. Don't do logging, don't go to a database, don't do input-output on files and stuff like that. In this way, your whole functional program becomes stateless and is actually a referential transparent, meaning that the function that you have can actually be replaced by the value that it produces. So for instance, if you say sum of 2 and 3, then you could just say 5 because it's the exact same thing. Now, this is a functional way of programming, and this is more declarative because you're saying what you are about to do. You're not actually doing it. And of course, this is a little bit weird because what if you have no side effects, no state? What does your app do then? Because are you just heating up your CPU or something, or you don't want to interact with customer or not store data? It just doesn't make sense. And of course, it indeed doesn't make sense because in the end, your application wants to do something pragmatically. So in order to fix that, the programmers of Haskell actually introduced effectful functions, actions. And we're getting to the more actual functional style here, where you do not want to actually execute a function or execute some code, but provide a description of how to execute something. And then if you have these effectful functions, you can actually compose them into other effectful functions with map and flat map. And then you can compose the main effectful program, which is the main effect. So instead of building your application with stateful objects that need to be injected in runtime, you can actually already compile time, developer time, state your whole full main program as an effectful composition of effectful functions. And then you can provide the dependencies and run the program when you actually run the program. So there are some words in here: effectful, map, flat map, compose, provide, run. What are those things? And how can you actually do that? How can you use map and flat map and compose all these functions into one function that is your program? And then, of course, the answer is monads. It's also still, what are those? Of course, if you go into this from a theoretical mindset, then a monad is just a monoid in the category of endofunctors. Well, yes, thanks. Still don't know what it means. So pragmatically, I think a monad can be viewed as a data structure that has something like map, something like flat map, And then if it really needs to be a monad, it needs to abide by three laws, the left identity, right identity, and associativity. But for the purposes of just pragmatically using a monad, I don't think that's actually necessary. Of course, if you're building a library, then you have to make sure that this is the case. But if you're just using it, well, just trust that this is the case. And then it is a monad. And when you have this data structure, then you can reason about the data inside that structure. That's it. So something like a map on an action that is in an IO of type A, if you then provide this map with a function, then it will just transform what is inside from A to B. But if you provide a function that does not yield a B from an A, but an IO of B from an A, then of course you need to flat map it to actually yield IO of B. There are a couple of monads. So every data structure that has map and flat map and abides by these rules can be considered having a monad. And then here are some options. I think, in Java, when you come across a list, you don't think of it as having a monad. In Java, also, you can consider it not having that. But of course, if you add methods like map and flat map, maybe it becomes a monad. There's maybe the option where you can reason about the effect of optionality. It's either there or not. Then you have the either construct, where you can reason about effects of it is either going to be this or that, which can be mainly used in error handling, for instance. So it's either an error or the answer. There is an action that is just a lazily evaluated. Which of course can be used to inject, if you will, impure code, or for instance, a connection to a database. A reader where you have some context and then some input and then reason about that. And then you can compose it, for instance, into a reader that has a context that does an action that yields an either an app exception or a list. This is still, of course, a little bit hand wavy, so hopefully we'll get to the code in a bit. But if you are going to flat map all these monads into one another, then you basically have some kind of callback hell or call hell. Because if you have an IO of something that yields a one, then you need to flat map this one and then a B and then yield a two, a three, just to compute 1 + 2 + 3. Which is not yet really pragmatic. So to comprehend monads, you actually need a monad comprehension, which is a different word to say it is syntactic sugar to actually get rid of these flat maps. So for instance, in Scala, you have the for comprehension, where you can just say for whatever monad you want to reason about, ABC, you can extract that 1, 2, 3, and then yield 1 + 2 + 3. So in this way, you don't have the nestedness and don't have the callback out. But this looks a bit familiar. For instance, in JavaScript, you have promises where you have .then to actually look inside a promise to get to the data. And then it's called callback hell because you're doing a callback to actually inspect the promise. Now, a promise isn't a monad because it's not lazily evaluated. It's not a description. So it looks familiar in the async await syntax as well. So technically, this is not a monad comprehension, but it tries to do the same thing where you actually can have syntactic sugar over a complicated flat map structure. So this is a little bit a background about the monads and how to compose them and map and flat map them into one another. But hopefully it makes more sense in code. So let's start looking into that. You can find this on GitHub in our Flock community in GitHub, where you can find it in K-Monad core. Because first I want to build up a functional core of some program. And I'm using Arrow to actually help me with that. Because Arrow is, well, according to their own website, a functional companion to Kotlin's standard library, where you can find all kinds of data structures that are indeed monad. So Let's begin by reconstructing a classic Spring Boot application with a repository, a service, and a controller, but do this in a way that uses monads to actually express your logic. So let's start with an interface that is a repository. And I am describing here a repository that has a get all function, a get by your UID, a save, and a delete by your UID. And the get all just gets a list of Jedi, and get by your UID gets a specific one, and you can save one, and you can actually delete one. So this is your basic CRUD repository to interact with some database in the end. But of course, this is not, this is now, it's still object-oriented programming. So we want to add some monads. So let's wrap it in an either. So we can reason about the error flow and the, which is on the left-hand side, and the actual happy flow, which is on the right-hand side, because right is right and left is wrong. Then you still need to wrap it in an IO because it's going to be an effect. It's going to be an action to actually call the database, which is not pure. So wrapping it in an IO actually makes that makes it a pure function, because now get all or get by your UID yields a an IO that then describes how to actually get to your data. So then in the service, I can just call that repository by introducing another monad, which is the reader monad, that actually states, okay, I want to construct a reader that takes in a repository and yields an IO of either exception or flow of Jedi. And you can construct that by just feeding it a function and then calling that repository. And this is all done by magic that, because you are saying that this is a reader and because you're saying that you expect a repository, you can indeed get a repository and then call get all. And the same holds for all the other methods. Now you can also use a type inference in Kotlin, so you can get rid of the whole type signature. So now I'm just saying I want to create a reader, and what I put in is a repository, and then the compiler knows, okay, I now know that you can call get all on that repository, or get by your UID, save, and etc. Now you can even write it a little bit different. You can make it more generic. You say, I don't care what kind of object I'm getting, what kind of dependency I'm getting, as long as it implements the repository. And then, of course, you can here say the generic form repository. Now, this is nice, but if you, for instance, want to add a dependency, this doesn't cut it. But luckily, Kotlin has the where syntax, where you can say, okay, I just want some generic thing, and it has to implement this repository. But now you can actually add something. For instance, you can say, I also want this generic thing to have implemented a logger. And then you can say, I want to construct a reader with R, this is my dependency, where I can call get by your UID because it's a repository. But I also, I can enter my IO, either map it, and then actually log my Jedi name. But just to show that we're not there yet, this might need some monad comprehensions, and but still I can log some name. And this is pure because it is an effect that is not executed right now, but someplace in the future when I actually run my program. Now it's nice that you actually can define that your dependencies has a repository, it has a logger, but maybe we should make that explicit. So in Scala, you have Zio, which is a functional library that was inspired. I was inspired by to actually use this this syntax or this concept, where you can say, okay, my dependency context has a Jedi repository or has a logger, and then you can, for instance, for every repository, state that you first go to a value, and then you have your get all. So in this case, you you can add different repositories that maybe have the same signature. And how does it, what does this look like? You can, for instance, have a sealed interface in Kotlin that is defined as has. and then define the different logger repositories on it. So in this way, you can actually state basically all your dependencies in your program. And in IntelliJ, of course, you have nice code completion. When you say has dot, then of course, because it's a sealed interface, IntelliJ knows what dependencies are already there. Then there is still one step, which is the controller. Note that we are not actually in a Spring context, so we don't have an actual HTTP layer here. But maybe we want to say, well, this is a controller because here we can do some validation. And then in the future, we need to bind this controller functionality to some actual handler. So here you can say, OK, I know that I need to provide my reader with some context, which is defined here. And this context needs to have HasLogger and HasRepository. In this case, HasJRRepository. Because if you don't do this, it won't compile. So this is, of course, the nice thing that you get with functional programming in this way, that your compiler already complains whether when you do not have injected your dependencies. So you could do, for instance, some validation here in your controller, where you say, OK, I want to have some UUID from string. This can fail. So if it fails, I want to, throw is not the right word. But I want to include it in the left either. But if it goes right, then I want to include it in the right either. And then because you are getting an either, you need to fold over it. And then you need to do some mono transformation, which granted is might not yet be really pragmatic. But this is a sense of what you get with these different containers and these different monads. And then, of course, you can reason about the UUID here in the right-hand side, where you can just call you get by UUID, provide it with the context, and call it. Now, of course, this is still just a description because I haven't actually run this this function. But I can actually test it. So how can we go about that? So in order to test it, I of course need an implementation. Someone's muting me. Okay. Never mind. So we need an implementation of our repository, and let's call it test repository, which is basically just backed by a map of some objects that we're going to return. So in this case, it's just a map of a UUID and some JRI, where I can return all these objects. I can just do a lookup into the map to actually get one by UUID. I can save one, ignore it because this is immutable, and delete one, but not really. So it's a nice example of a test repository that stays immutable, stays always the same, in this case doesn't change. And as you can see, the way you can create an either from something that is right is with extension functions dot write, and if it's not right, then it's left. So this way you have constructed a test repository that is an actual implementation that behaves like a repository. And then you can use it in a test. You can just use your JUnit, for instance, to actually test it. And this is how it actually works. This is how it's going to run. You're actually getting the bind-get method, or I should say function, from the controller file. Then you are providing your context to your reader. Then you can say, then you get back an IO. You can run that. And then you can map over the either, take to the list, and then take the first two, and then assert whether or not it's the correct object. And this is where you actually run your program. So all the rest is just a function that you invoke. And if you do this once, twice, three times, you will always get the same thing. So this is an actual function that maps from one input to the other. Now, of course, there is still this context here. So what's that? Well, that's actually the context that you have defined, where you say, I need to have a logger and I need to have a repository. And this is where you actually inject your test logger and your test repository. So in this way, you have a fully functional stack where you have defined a context that you actually provide to your reader monad, and then you run your IO, and then you map over your IDER to actually handle the data that you get back. And you can also test your exceptions, because once you have run all your code, you can still say on your IDER monad, get or handle. And then, of course, you can just do whatever you want with it. You can throw it, because you're now inside a context that actually can handle these exceptions. Or, of course, you can unwrap the exception and actually return a string, for instance, with a message to output. So this is all tested inside that K-Monad core. But of course, we also want to run a functional program live. And this is done in another repository, just for me to make sure that I didn't forget anything. And of course, you could use Spring. Why not? Let's keep doing things pragmatically. And if you're using Spring, then of course, you can just use everything that Spring has to offer. And maybe most importantly, if you are already programming in a Spring Boot application, you can just start making this more functional if you want. So then you need to implement a live repository, which is, again, an extension of your repository. You need some live context, for instance, some configuration that is a database client or a connection string or something like that. And then you can implement it. So I'm creating an IO here, and then some private implementation details as how to get the IDER, but we'll get to that. And this is, of course, the same interface with the same signatures as before. But most importantly, there is this live context that provides you with the actual database connection. And again, you can write it like this, where you define a live context that is just a has live sealed interface with a database client. The same way we have defined it in the K-Monad core. Now, if you then look at the IDERs, how did they implement that? So in order to return an IO of either internal server error, this is an app exception, or a flow of JEDI, you can just use this collection and find everything that's in there, and have this extension method here that's called write. But if you, for instance, have you want to find a single JEDI, then of course it could be that this is not found. And then maybe you have an app exception that is a not found app exception. And this is where you get the monad comprehension syntax. And this is also from Arrow, where you can define an either effect scope, where inside this either effect, you can do your business logic, where you can indeed find one JEDI in your collection where the ID is equal to the UUID. And this will then be a JEDI of type JEDI question mark, with a maybe JEDI. And you can just return that. But if it's null, you can bind this exception to the left-hand side of your either effect. And in this way, you'll have, with a structured way, you have defined your happy and your not so happy flow. Then the save as either is maybe a bit more complicated, but it's the same ID. So you are inside the either scope. You're getting a UUID. You are using the get UUID as either to actually get an either of a JEDI. When there is one, then I have a conflict. So that's not good. So it's left. And then I have to bind it to this scope. Else, I want to insert this JEDI. And if that result was acknowledged, I return it. And if not, if something indeed went wrong, then that's an internal server error. And of course, this is how you can actually compose your methods in your repository. Again, with the the either scope. So here, which is really nice, by the way, is because you are in this monad comprehension or this either comprehension, you can get a JEDI by UUID. And because this is an either, and because we are in the either scope, you can just bind that to the scope. So you can reason here about an actual JEDI. So not about an either, not about the container, but the actual thing that is inside. And then, of course, just like async await, you have awaited here something that you can reason about. And then you can actually delete this one and take it. And if this was indeed correct, then return it. And then, of course, it will be returned as an either of app exception in JEDI. Okay, well, really nice. We have dealt with the side of the repository in the live context. Now, of course, we have to deal with the HTTP layer of the side of the live or live context. And of course, if you do this in Spring, then you can just use the Spring annotations. And notice that I'm not using the REST controller here, but annotations that are actually wrapped by REST controller, but not the bean annotation. And that's, of course, there's a reason behind it. But the rest is just a normal get mapping, request mapping between the endpoint and the actual implementation. I need to have some context because I still need to provide the repository and the logger. But if you do that, then you can just call the function and be done with it. And then in the end, what is hidden by this handle is if you are calling this block, so for instance, bind get, you can provide the context, run, and get or handle, and then throw it. And of course, this looks a little bit weird because why are we going to throw exceptions again? Well, because there is a nice exception handling mechanism in Spring that we all know, and this is the edge of my my program, so that's maybe fine.
Don't you want to handle those errors maybe already?
So don't you want to handle these errors in your service? It depends. If there are, of course, errors that are saying, well, your basket is wrongfully updated, maybe yes. But if it's something like your UUID is not a UUID, then maybe no, because that's already in the controller. But I think that's the same as with OOP. When you are wrapping it in a try-catch, you want to decide where you want to handle your exceptions. But of course, in this case, it is part of the signature and it's part of the return type. That yes, there is a there is an exception there, maybe. So in order to actually register this as a bean that Spring can actually handle, we need to register it in the configuration as a bean, but note that there are no dependencies here. You can just construct the JEDI handler and actually provide it with the context where you have your live JEDI repository and your live logger. Now, what is this live layer here? This is also an ID from Zio. That is basically your configuration. So, of course, you need to get your configuration in your program at some point that you are running it at some host with some port, and you can do that here as well. So this is basically the app, and it works because if you then run this app, you can go to your local host and actually call it. So it's also nice that yes, it works, but I don't feel that this is particularly pragmatic because it's still a lot of IO, either, reader, and all these kinds of things. You said, well, you might not need to know about all these monads. So what's up with this? I want pragmatic functional programming, not functional programming with all these callback handles. Okay, so let's see whether or not we can leverage the standard functions of Kotlin and see whether or not we can get a referential transparent program with just using Kotlin. So we're going to build another repository, another service, and another controller, but we're going to use only Kotlin features. So this is a new repository. We are now not thinking about Jedi anymore, but about Sif. So we're returning a flow of Sif, or when we get one, or delete one, or save one, we're going to just return the one object. And you can already note that we're not returning an IO here, but we're just suspending this function. Because a suspended function is also a function that will happen in the future. So it doesn't run here. Then in your service, you can actually use the same syntax, where R has Sif repository, for instance. You can define it generic. But in Kotlin, we have extension methods. So what we can do is we can actually add an extension method on our context, and then we can reason about this as well. So we do not actually need the reader monad to get a reader-like monadic experience. And we can, of course, also add haslogging and stuff like that. Then in the controller, we just need to define the context like before, but this is now an extension method on context. And because it's an extension method on context, the get all extension method from the service, you can just call. Same here, you can validate things. And I think this looks way more pragmatic than the others. I hope you agree. So let's see what this looks like in the test and live. This is basically the same implementation as the Jedi repository, but it's... so now I have to override a suspended function and return it as a flow. There are still just these indexes, but I already noticed that I am throwing stuff. So maybe that's not the way to go. But let's continue. The tests are actually quite simple. It's just a context. You bind the get, you take two, and you assert whether or not they're there. And the same for assert for throws for your unhappy flow, they're just thrown exceptions, so you can test whether or not they are thrown. The same is there for the object with the context. So for this approach, we can take the same way of defining the context, and everything is now a extension method on context. How does this work live? Well, still you need a live implementation. We can take the same approach with has live database client, has logger, whatever you want to implement there. It says live context with a collection. And it is mostly the same implementation, but here I am seeing a lot of throws. This I'm not really happy with, because throwing stuff will indeed say, okay, it's out of my control now. You need to do something else in some context to actually handle these exceptions. So maybe this is not the whole way to go. But then, of course, in the handlers, you can just handle these binds, and then these are extension methods on context. And then we can just add them next to the Jedi handler. We can rename these repositories and these contexts with import aliases, so you can actually see that it's a little bit different. It's also nice that you can actually just use context and a repository in a package. And in here, we can just rename them. And this also works, which is, of course, nice. So to wrap this up a little bit, I've talked a little about monads, and I gave some examples of what constructs actually have monads. So this is either the IO, the reader, and that you can actually compose this with map and flat map into something that returns a reader that has a context and provides has a context. You need to provide the context, and it yields an IO of either app exception or string. Now, if you just use Kotlin features, then we might in the future look at result, which maybe isn't either. I don't know. It doesn't have the either comprehension, so that's maybe a no. But suspend is a nice alternative for IO. extension methods is a nice alternative for Reader. And then, of course, you can combine these as well. So maybe what we need to do is have these Kotlin features and then include the arrow either, because then you, of course, have a nice way of reasoning about all your data and happy flows and unhappy flows. So to conclude, how does that look? We can create a new repository for a new service or a new controller, a new module in our Spring Boot application that actually is a suspended function that gets either an app exception or a flow of droids, get by UUD save and delete by UUD. Then to reuse the extension method alternative, we can write this. And then again, we can actually use the either comprehension to do our business logic inside of this either comprehension in the service, which I think is a really nice way of handling your errors and your happy flow. So if you are doing this, then you are getting all of your droids from the droid repository, and then you bind this write result to this either effect. And the same, of course, holds for all the other methods. And still, you can add dependencies with this R has syntax. Then for your controller, see that we are actually getting rid of these weird two-reader syntax when you're validating a something that that is wrapped in an either and an IO. So here you can just reason about the validated UUID that you got from your input string. And then if it's right, then you can just bind it to your context. And then you indeed have, just like you would read a recipe or a procedure, you just get this UUID, put it into your next function, and bind it to your scope. So how do you test this? Well, basically with the same test implementation, we've seen this. Either it's right or it's left, and then you can just use these this extension method syntax again, bind this to your either comprehension, and reason about the result. Context is the same, and then we can also have an implementation, a live implementation, where we are again using the either comprehension. By now, I think it's it makes sense to do it like this. You can bind your unhappy flow and your happy flow, and then in this way, you have a nice implementation that is fully referentially transparent. And then it looks like this in the controller with the same context, and you can just add it into your configuration, and this also works. So I think to conclude that we should use these Kotlin features natively, extended with the arrow either. And in this way, you can, I think, have a fully functional way of programming that is pragmatic, but not over the top with all these monads. Actually, when I was doing this, I went back to Arrow. And then I read that they, probably a lot earlier than me, already came to the same conclusion that they are deprecating IO. And now they're live in the last weeks, I guess, with version 1.0. And there you cannot find an IO there, and you cannot find a reader there, because they also say, well, Kotlin is already a really nicely advanced language where you can actually use the suspend keyword and the extension function methods. So I'm really glad that I'm not the only one, at least, and already there are other people knowing that know way more about functional programming than me came to the same conclusion. Just as a side note, if you are interested in Scala functional programming, I really recommend the library Zio, where I got the has syntax and the layer concepts from. it's probably not the same as in Zio, but it's still in a way of reasoning about this composition of layers is really nice. And with that, I would like to thank you. Are there any questions?
I do have a question.
I will repeat the question. What is the adoption of Arrow in the Kotlin community? The answer, at least from my side, is I don't know. Until very recently, it was still in beta. There was not yet a production release. But as I said, just a couple of weeks ago, they released 1.0.0. I think it's 1.0.1 right now. I think it's a nice evolution of trying to figure out how to do functional programming in Kotlin with this library, and then indeed reaching the same conclusion that you can actually ditch IO and Reader for functions that are already in the language. Yeah, so the question is, the suspend keyword, does it support throwing exceptions? Yes. So you can just, with Kotlin coroutines, you have to start a coroutine, and then within that, you can run suspended functions. And in those functions, you can just throw exceptions. But there is also an effect or a method that is called run catching. And if you put a function in there that throws an exception, then it will be caught by that run catching, and then it'll actually wrap it in a result. And then you have access to the actual result or the exception. So it is a smaller either, I would say, where you do not have the type, the error type, but it's always a throwable. So it's actually an either of throwable and, well, whatever generic type you put in there. But unfortunately, the two places are reversed. So if you want to fold over a result to actually make it an either, you first your first function is the actual result, which is on the left hand side, and then the other is the actual exception, which is on the right hand side, which is a bit weird if you're coming from functional programming. But of course, the same concept. But just I will repeat the question. So it's about controller advice. Is there a way to maybe replace the controller advice in Spring as well? I haven't looked into that yet, but because I created the app exception, and that is a sealed hierarchy of exceptions like not found, conflict, internal server error, and bad request, then in that exception handler, I only have two exception handlers in the controller advice, which is just a generic exception, because I might have missed something. And the other one is the exception, and then I use a when clause to actually move over all the exceptions that my application will throw. So if I add an app exception to that shield hierarchy, then it will still be in there. But yeah, I'm using the controller advice there to do the exception.
Okay. Yeah, because I'm trying to implement it myself, actually, with the proof of concept. And what we're running into is the fact that the types don't match. Something that with the controller advice is not really a problem because you're inside of a proxy. So you can just have that. So that's a limitation, I think. Wondering if you ran into that yourself.
Yeah, I'm not creating different exception handlers for the different exceptions anymore. So I just create one exception handler that then just matches over the sealed hierarchy.
Yeah, so basically you're doing functional programming until like the front of the world kind of, and then you say I kind of do the regular OOP thing again in the front.
Yes, exactly. So the thing that so if you're talking about being in control and inversion of control, then I want to be in control over the stuff I program, maybe pragmatically to 95%, if you will. And then the only thing that I still need to relegate to the Spring container is then throwing the exception, but then immediately catching it in the controller device and then basically doing it functional style again.
Yeah, true. Okay. Well, that clears things
up. Of course, you can also, the nice thing about this is I actually also use the KMonad core and then use it in a KTOR application context. And then it's also way more functional. But it's of course also less widely used as Spring.
Yeah, and you have some problems with the coroutines, for example, things like tracing. Dyn trace doesn't work, so that's a bit of an issue currently.
Yeah.
Adopting Ktor. But okay, thank you for your answers.
Yeah, thanks for your question.
That's back to me again. I want to thank you all for joining on this talk. This is basically was the official part of the meetup. So again, thank you, and maybe we'll see you in the next meetup.